Do you want to take your 3D print designs from Dribulous to Fabulous, from ordinary to extraordinary, novice to pro? Well, in this video, I'm going to give you some tips on how to do just that. That is an overly dramatic YouTuber, but even if you're not trying to be a professional 3D designer and make a living off of it, that one picked up some tricks the hard way that you might be able to use to improve your personal work and maybe go pro thanks to this video. Rude. Let's get to this. I'm going to provide you a checklist of tasks you can do to your 3D design work to make it inarguably better. I'm sure there are plenty of you out there saying, well, I'm not a pro designer and I don't want to be one. Why should I care about any of this? To that, I have to say, if you could do some simple tasks for free and quickly to make your design work better, why wouldn't you want to do that? And I never expected to be deriving a pretty good percentage of my monthly income from my 3D design work, and here I am. Having knowledge is powerful, and you never know where it's going to take you. And that line of thinking, knowledge is power, is shared by this video's sponsor, the fun and interactive online learning platform, Brilliant.org. Gaining new skills is never a bad thing, and you can do it free and easy with the courses at Brilliant. They have basic to advanced classes in a range of subjects: math, computer science, engineering, data science. There's so much here, and there's new content added monthly. Brilliant can help you reach your learning goals. Ruby and I both wanted to learn a little bit about coding, so we both started with some basic computer science courses. We're both lifelong learners, and we love the bite-sized courses at Brilliant that really can fit into our busy self-employed work schedules. She's moved on to sharpening her math skills so she can dive deeper into probability and statistics courses. Most recently, I've been tackling logic problems just to keep myself on my toes and actively thinking. From beginner to pro, there's so many courses and topics you could learn with Brilliant. All of this, and you could get started for free for 30 days. And the first 200 of you that follow my link, brilliant.org/mandicreally, will get 20% off a premium subscription. Start learning by doing today. For the sake of full transparency, this came about because I was downloading some files and I kept running into these similar issues over and over again. Things that I learned to correct in my own designs a while ago before I released files, and I want to share the information with you folks. That said, I will only be showing examples of my own designs in this video, nobody else's. I'm not putting anybody on blast except myself. So let's dive into this. Not every item on our list is going to require CAD software. Some of it can be done in Slicer or through other means. However, our first item does require being done in CAD, and it's also our most involved topic of this entire video, so there are timestamps in the description if you want to jump around a little bit. The first list item is export high quality STLs. These are both STLs of my Krampus can cup design, but the one on the left was exported at low detail settings. You can see the blockiness on the nose and the teeth. It really shows, and it will show on a final print as well. The other one is actually using my release settings, how I would feel comfortable releasing this design to the public. And you can see the polygons are still there, but they are much smaller. They will not translate into the final print. Now, if aesthetics aren't your concern, you're just worried about making practical, functional objects, this can still be a concern for you. Just look at the shape of these two holes. Green one on the left and the yellow one on the right. They're totally different shapes. The decimation, the reduction in quality of the low quality export is going to cause dimensional issues in this part. You might not be able to get a bolt through that hole, or the head may not recess into the counter bore as it's supposed to. So let's get into CAD and I'll show you how to adjust settings. I'm going to show you in Autodesk Fusion 360. This is the software that I use. It's free to get started with, so a lot of people have access to it. It's what I'm gonna show you. I have the Krampus can cup design project open here. I'm gonna right click on the Krampus body and then save as mesh. That'll get me to the save as mesh dialog box, which is where we need to make our adjustments to improve our resolution of our STL export. This drop-down refinement, that's our main focus. Low is the low quality one that I already showed you. You can see where the sliders for surface deviation and normal deviation are. Now I'll go to high and they both drop. Surface deviation and normal deviation are telling the CAD software how much it can deviate from our existing design that we created to create the mesh for our STL. For the majority of projects, I really don't recommend going below high. In fact, for my own work, I generally take the surface deviation and the normal deviation and I divide them by 2 to get even finer results out of my projects. There are reasons you might not want to do that though, file sizes. If you compare from low all the way up to the highest quality, the custom one that I created, there's a drastic difference, all the way down at around 2 megabytes up to 44 to 45 megabytes in file size. That's a big difference, and it can also mean issues in Slicer. If you export a very large object like this, or something that has a lot of detail in it, maybe a Flexi Dragon or something like that, and you go at a very high detail, that means there's going to be more polygons that make up that shape. If it was that fine detail with all those polygons, it would be hard on the Slicer to import it and to process it. You would need a powerful computer to work with it, and it still might be slow, as Slicers aren't the most optimized software out there. I personally wouldn't want to release a design that's going to be difficult for the majority of people to slice in their slicer. So this export here is a lower quality than my regular ones usually are, just because it, for reasonable sake, it has to be that way. That's one item checked off our list. Next is, as Nero said, orient your parts. If you've ever built a Voron or a Mercury 1 3D printer, you'll notice something when you import the parts for them. They import in exactly the orientation that they're intended to be printed in. This is a little detail that will go a long way to making people subconsciously feel really good about your 3D models. Because the flip side is, you're done your design, you're happy with where it's at, you go and export it as it sits there. It is very easy to lose track of what the heck is up and down in CAD when we can move the camera 360 degrees around an object. The person downloading our models loads it up in their slicer, and now that body is upside freaking down. You may not think twice about this because some slicers have auto orientation tools. Prusa Slicer, you can do place on face, boom, it's oriented the way it's supposed to be. But that's a step that your end users had to go through to get your model to where it's ready to be printed. And that's going to leave them thinking less of your design. Or sometimes a print orientation is open to interpretation. Something like this here, and this is an extreme example, but this could be printed standing up just like this with a little bit of support on some of these overhang areas. But that's not the way I intended it. I intended it on the face this way. I just didn't orient it because it's a part that I designed for myself and nobody else. We as designers, I can speak for myself here anyway, can lose sight of the fact that people aren't in our heads. They don't know what we were thinking when we designed something to know how it's meant to be. So we need to take as many obstacles and variables out of the way as we can for them to get a good result. I started doing this after I started printing a bunch of Voron parts and realized how nice it was to just drop things onto the print bed and not think twice about it. It made me feel good about the Voron design team. I wanted people to feel that way about my models, so I started doing it. This is an instance where this is easily corrected in Slicer. I'll just place it on the orientation that I actually intended to be in. Then we can go to File, Export, Export Plate as STL, and there we go. It will export our model in the orientation we intended it to be printed, and we can use that as our final release version. That's two tips down. Time for the third, which is check your models for watertight. That one's not, AKA manifold. Okay, watertight doesn't actually have anything to do with whether your vase mode print can hold water. It has to do with the structural integrity of your STL. This incomplete 3D scan of the gauge cluster from a project I did some time ago shows you what I mean by non-watertight. You can see into the scan. That's non-watertight. So how can you know whether your STLs are non-watertight? The easiest method I know is Prusa Slicer. Here's that pile of parts I was referring to for this lid in Prusa Slicer, and you can see right above my head here is an orange triangle with an exclamation point in the middle of it. That is telling me this is non-manifold, non-watertight. Non-manifold and non-watertight are just two terms for the same concept. Probably the biggest question here is, why should I care? You've probably printed plenty of things with that orange triangle on them, and they printed just fine. But there's a reason you should care. Looking again at this model and slicing it as is, not worrying about the fact that it's not manifold, we'll find an issue pretty quickly. If I zoom in on this drill bit here after slicing, there's a whole section of that that is not there. It's there in the model as far as we can see, but the slicer doesn't see it because that is non-watertight. If we hover over that orange triangle that I mentioned before and then click it, Prusa Slicer will actually send this STL out to the NetFab service, to repair the model and fix those issues and then bring it back in a repaired form. And as far as you can tell, there's just a little progress bar on the screen, and that's all that's going to happen here, and it will get working eventually. With the repaired model loaded back in, we can take a look at it and see that it definitely repaired it, but not exactly 100% how we would have wanted to do it. I find 9 times out of 10 that slicer repair method is good enough. If it is, we can actually just then go to File, Export, Plate as STL, and then you can export the repaired STL out of Prusa Slicer and upload that as your finished model. If it's an object where dimensions really, really matter, and maybe the repair messed up a section, that can happen, or you're just not happy with the way that the slicer did the job, you're gonna have to go into CAD. Back here in Fusion 360, I brought in this bad 3D scan of Felix the cat because you can very clearly see inside of the model. It is not watertight, and that's quite apparent. There's also an indication here in Fusion. Above my head there is another yellow triangle this time, and that says mesh is not closed. If we click that, we'll open up the repair dialog box. This gives us options to more control the repair of our mesh than in the slicer option did. We can close holes, we can stitch and remove, and if we hit preview, it will actually give us a preview of what the repair will look like. In this case, stitch and remove, since it's a simple straight hole in the bottom of this, will work pretty well. I'm not gonna go any deeper in this video on this particular topic because I can make probably a whole video about this, and I'm not gonna claim to be a particular expert in this. This is the tool I'll use if the slicer one isn't quite doing what I want. I can get a little more refined here in Fusion than I could there. Watertight down, it's time for tip number 4. Consider providing a step file. Step is a 3D file format that is quite compatible. So I work in Fusion 360, but not everybody does. So when I share out my projects, I share step files so somebody working in SolidWorks or Onshape can open it up without issue. There are a few good reasons you might want to include step files when you release designs. Like, if you're open to allowing remixing on your designs, which let's face it, most of the licenses that a lot of us 3D designers use do allow for remixing whether we like it or not. This makes it easy. I can grab his face here, I can extrude it 10 millimeters. Done, that easy. Meanwhile, if I import that exact same STL, this is going to be so much more difficult to work with. It's not directly editable. I can't just grab a face and extrude it. That same face is made up of a bunch of polygons and triangles. So I would have to convert this to a body, which is a slow process. You can see that black bar on the side over there. That means it's thinking. That conversion just took this long. Not quick at all. And it totally screwed the body up. In fact, it's actually not watertight now. So it's useless. I cannot work with this file. All STLs are annoying to work with. That one was just especially bad. But there's another good reason to include step files. That is, Prusa Slicer and forks of it like Bamboo Studio can now import step files. What they're really doing is converting the step file into an STL in the slicer, and it does a really good job of it. On the left in green is my high detail export of Krampus. On the right is the step file imported. And yeah, mine is better, but is it really that much better? And the step file version is significantly smaller in file size. My final export version, I mentioned earlier, it's about 45 megabytes. The step file, 10 megabytes. I'm not at all saying to abandon STL and go with step files. STLs are going to be the most compatible file format for slicing across the board currently. So stick with providing STLs, but this is a solid reason to provide step files too, though there's one drawback here. At least in Fusion 360 that I use, there's not a good way to export all of these files individually in step format. If you try to export this, in this particular case, it means 54 bodies would be exported as one step file. Just for the fun of it, this is what it looks like if you import that. You can split it up into individual items and delete the ones you don't want. That's such a pain. We've got 4 tips down, and our last couple of tips are pretty quick and simple ones. The first of which is slice your designs. Please bear with me on this. I know it sounds insultingly simple, and it is, but this is one of my number one tips in all of 3D printing. What I mean is really looking at your slice design, really paying attention to it, because this model looks perfectly fine. As I showed before, this design, when you slice it, there's this whole spot where there's no extrusion there. That portion of the print will fail. If that happened much lower in the print area, then the entire print may be ruined. I've been known to export versions of my design as I go and then slice them just to check for things I might have missed, because I'll constantly put together two separate bodies into one and create something like this cylinder right here. Looks like a perfectly normal cylinder. I want that to print just like this, right? So I bring my cylinder into the slicer. It doesn't have the red triangle of doom on it. It's good. I could just hit export G-code and send it to the printer. Unless I really think to look at it and then realize it's not right. Now, obviously, I manufactured this issue here, but I can't tell you the number of times that I have sliced a design only to see an issue with it and not even bother printing it because it was going to fail or at least produce poorer quality than I would be happy with, and that was apparent. I've caught and saved myself from so many issues just by really looking at my slice designs, and I try to do it before every single print I ever send, no matter whether I made the design or not. Five down, time for the final tip on our checklist. I'm sorry, but this is one more insultingly simple one. Print your files. I'm sorry if this comes off harsh, but I've seen it too many times where a description of her design says, haven't printed yet. If you haven't printed it, you probably shouldn't be releasing the design. I'm sorry if that statement offends anybody who has done that. I realize this feels like it comes from a place of privilege. All this filament, all these machines to prototype with. It's easy for me to say that. But even when all I had was a single Ender 3 and three or four spools of filament in my office, this is still how I did things, because whether it's your first design or your 100th design, there's simply no replacement for holding your printed design in your hands and nitpicking it like that. Seeing it, what worked and what didn't, what dimensions are the scale you hoped they would be, and what ones are maybe a little too big or a little too small. And with that, our final tip is checked off the list. I hope folks understand where I'm coming from here. I learned these things the hard way. I understand when you're 40 hours deep into a design project and you just want to be done with it, you can upload it, walk away, touch grass. The little details, they're pretty easy to miss at that point. And that's what I'm trying to say. Those are the things that can take your designs up a notch. And for those of you who made it this far in the video, there's a free download link in the description for an actual checklist of these items to help you remember to go through these steps when you're wrapping up your design projects. You can digitally check it off, or you can print it out and physically do so, whichever works for you. If you have any tips you think can improve people's design work, let us know in the comments. Maybe we can do a follow-up commenters edition of this video. And remember, check your STLs for manifold. Hope you found this video interesting. If you did, maybe you'll enjoy this one where I 3D designed on a Chromebook, or this one which YouTube thinks is best for you. Get subscribed to ensure your 3D prints don't fail. It's not a guarantee, but it can't hurt. See you, folks.